I'm going to preach a little different sermon tonight. It's not going to be Romans 6, not going to even be the message of the cross, but I do hope that it's encouraging and uplifting to you. Those of you that have been in track and in sports, you know you get that second wind. And I don't know, if you've been like me the last few months, it's kind of hard sometimes to keep up that pace, to keep running, keep going this race. Amen? And I hope tonight maybe I can help you get a little second wind to get that extra kick to go. Amen. I'm going to title this, Four Cracked Pots. If you turn with me to Hebrews, the 11th chapter, 11:32. Four Cracked Pots. Now don't get hung up on that title and forget where we went. Hebrews 11:32. When you get there, say amen. Amen. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell you about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this evening for your word. Lord, we thank you that it is life to our spiritual life. Lord, we just ask that you'd come, Lord, just bless it to our needs. Lord, each one of us, we have a need in our heart, Lord, that a spiritual gift we need tonight. Father, I ask for the anointing, the flowing of your spirit as we sang in the song this evening. Lord, let it flow. Let it flow. Let it be an encouragement tonight, Lord, for those that may be dwindling, Lord, that may be in their strength flowing out. Father, I pray for a mighty, mighty move in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. As I said, the name of this is Four Cracked Pots. I could have named it Crackpot, but it's like cracked pots, flawed vessels. Now you get the picture? Flawed vessels. Hebrews chapter 11 tells us of the long list of the heroes of faith that Paul lays out in there. There's a long list. And he finally gets down to the end of the chapter, and he comes down to our text in verses 32 and 34. And he's running out of, I guess, who knows? He's running out of space. He's running out of time. He seems to be a little hurried. He says, what more shall I say? I don't have time to tell you about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah. Don't have time. I believe the writer of Hebrews, actually to be Paul, a lot of people are in discussion about that, but I believe personally that Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. And as one Bible version puts it in that, he says, I could go on, but I've run out of time. So he must have been kind of in a pinch to finish up whatever it was he was discussing, which was the total of 11th chapter of Hebrews, which is the book of the heroes of the Bible, the heroes of faith. To me, Hebrews 32 in particular is like a preacher at 11:52 in the morning when he's got to finish by noon so everybody can beat the Baptist to the McDonald's, you know. You've got a few options. You can either carry it over to 12:20, 12:30, make everybody mad, and you probably won't get invited to preach again. Or you can cut it short, wind it up, finish on time. But like all truly gifted speakers, the author of Hebrews, which is Paul, apparently could read the clock on the wall, and he knew that it was time to wrap up his chain of thought. He knew that he had plenty of material to go through, and he decided that having already made his point, that he was going to not belabor the issue, he was just going to wrap it up. So because he didn't have time to elaborate the full story of all these heroes of the faith, he decided to mention only a few names and then go for the finishes in verses 33 to 40. But in verse 32, he mentions four names of virtually unknown men. Some of you may not have heard it. You may not have ever even read these portions in the Old Testament. These four men that he mentions were in the period of the Judges. He mentions David and Samuel, of course, whom we're all familiar with. And he also mentions a group called the prophets, which is a conglomeration of everyone that included from Elijah to Malachi. Now, David and Samuel, we know pretty well. Their stories are pretty much out there, and they stand head and shoulders above all the rest because of their exemplary faith that they showed and displayed in serving God. But who are these others? Who in the world is Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah? How did he pick them out? How did he go to them? He names four men from the ancient period of the Judges, which was a wild time in the Bible, actually, because it tells us in Judges 21:25, everyone did what was right in his own eyes. That's a recipe for a lot of trouble. So here's what we do know about these four men. Gideon defeated the Midianites. Barak defeated the Canaanites. Samson defeated the Philistines. Jephthah defeated the Ammonites. These four men are only mentioned in this one spot in all of the New Testament. That fact alone ought to make us want to pay a little attention and see what, like they used to say, what the rest of the story is. We also need to know that each of these four men had some very significant flaws. No plaster saints here. No goody two-shoes. They were real men of flesh and blood, that just like you and I, that have problems, they had issues, they had problems in their lives. But God himself considered them men of faith in spite of their flaws. Their faith was much like ours. It was at times mingled with fear, frequently soiled with unbelief and doubt, often spotted with compromise and troubled by human reasoning. You know, sometimes we overthink stuff. You do that? Yeah, good. I don't want to think I'm the only one that does that. But God honored these men. It was true faith. Imperfect faith, yes. Badly flawed, yes. But faith nonetheless. God knew all about their faults. How many know that God knows your inside and out? He knows your fault line, where it lies. He knows exactly. He knows exactly what you're made of. But he honored their faith anyway. So hold on to that word anyway. We're going to come back to it later. Number one was Gideon. Gideon was fearful. Paul says, I don't have time to tell you about Gideon. And if we travel back in time over 3,000 years to meet a man named Gideon, we'd find that the angel of the Lord came to him one day and said, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. And he said, I've never even been in a fist fight. Me, Lord? Me? God called him a mighty warrior, though, before he had ever even fought a battle. He knows what you can be before you even wake up to it and realize that God has made you something that is different. That surprise came to him right in the middle of the severe Midianite oppression that Israel was going under. And I'm sure Gideon's response at that time was to look at the angel and say, who, me? You know? I don't know about you, but maybe you've been in a job somewhere and the boss sees some capabilities in you that you didn't know you had. And he says, I want you to go over here and do this and that because he knows you can do it. And you're like, you're talking to me? You know? Well, that's kind of the way he was feeling. Here the Midianites were a vast army of the east who invaded riding on camels. They'd come each year during harvest time as the Israelites were bringing in their harvest of their crops. They'd plunder the land and steal everything that they'd worked for all year long. Then ride out of town and stay away until next year it was time to come back and do it again. When you look at Gideon's life, you don't see a man of great faith. You see a man of weak faith, but a man who God still used greatly. Every year at harvest time, the Israelites were losing everything that they'd worked for because the Midianites kept invading, they kept stealing, they kept coming every year. They knew they were going to be there. The people of God were even reduced to living in caves to be safe from them. They were so frightened of the mighty power that the Midianites had. So in response to this crisis, God tapped Gideon on the shoulder and said, I'm going to use you to deliver my people. The angel of the Lord was pretty clear about that too, because he repeated it two or three times in Judges 6. So after God finally convinces him and he takes command of the army, they're out here and the stage is set and Finally, the showdown between the Midianites and the Israelites was all set. The men are all gathered. The enemy's approaching. Everybody's ready for great battle, and they're all slapping each other on the shoulder, saying, you know, let's get ready. Everybody was ready, except for Gideon. He's still not sure he's the right man to lead Israel. At that point, Gideon asked God to give him a sign, an unmistakable proof that he had really called Gideon to do this. He even named the sign. He put out a fleece and asked God to make the fleece wet and the ground dry. And guess what? God did it. And good old Gideon, that still wasn't enough for him. So he asked God to do just the opposite the next night. Some people just, you know. Only then did Gideon finally believe what God had told him to do in the beginning. Now, it's not a sin to ask God for a fleece, but it was a sign of weak faith. Because he already knew what God had told him to do. It wasn't a mystery. God had told him very plainly, very bluntly, exactly what he wanted him to do. Sometimes we're like Gideon. It's easy to sit back and say, well, old Gideon, man, he's the laughing stock, you know, I don't know about him, you know. But we're just like Gideon. God, did you really say that? Now, give me a fleece. If you do this, if you, whatever, then I'll believe that you are talking to me. All that is an indicator that your faith needs a little bolstering. You need to believe God and what he said. God honors faith, not doubt. I mean, if he finally comes to your aid after you ask him like Gideon did four or five favors about the fleece, if he finally does answer you, that's just grace and mercy. Because he's looking for real faith. He's looking for people that say, I believe God. I believe what God told me. That settles it. That's it. We're not going any further. I believe my God. If you read Judges 7, you see how God used Gideon and his 300 men to spring a nighttime surprise on the unsuspecting Midianites. He used a classic military tactic to make his army look bigger than what it really was. They had to do something that was unusual because the enemy forces, the Bible says, was thick as locusts. They were greatly outnumbered. So he divided his 300 men into three different groups and spread them around the Midianites. And then at night, in the middle of the night when everybody was asleep, he had them to raise up and everybody began to yell and they lit torches and made a lot of noise. And the Midianites didn't know what was happening because it was dark. It's in the middle of the night. It looks like they're outnumbered and it's time to get out of town, Jack. And that's what they did. The Midianites fled. Total confusion. Turns out that Gideon actually made a fine military leader once he got past his fear. As long as he thought he couldn't do it, he was right. You know, you're the same way. As long as you keep telling God you can't do it, you're right. You're right. But once faith replaced his fear, he won a mighty victory for the Lord. Then there is Barak. Yeah, Barak was timid, which is ironic because his name actually means lightning. And you're thinking, man, this guy's got a lightning tattoo on his arm. He's got lightning on his black leather jacket. He is cool. He is, you know, he's out there. But the Bible says that he was timid. Listen to his story. Paul says, I don't have time to tell you about Barak. But it's interesting to note, whenever you mention Barak's name, you have to come up with another name too, which was Deborah. It wasn't just Barak in the story. It's Barak and Deborah. So who's Deborah? She's not his wife. She's not his sister. Who was she? Deborah was the only female judge of Israel. The spiritual life of Israel had fallen so low that they actually had to get a woman, which was totally uncustomary for their culture. Now, I'm not saying anything against women. Don't get me wrong. I'm just telling you the way the culture was back in those days. That's not meaning to knock Deborah at all, because she's clearly very brave, decisive, and bold. She judged Israel because none of the men would step forward to do the job. Oh, I could say a lot about that. After 20 years of the humiliating oppression at the hands of the Canaanites, God raised up this prophetess to represent him to the people. So since Barak commanded the army, Deborah sent for him and told him it was time to go to battle. Had enough of this Midianite stuff. We're going to go to battle. She even devised the battle plan and gave it to him. I mean, what's this guy drawing his pay for? Seriously. Judges 4, 6, and 7 says this. She sent for Barak, son of Abinadi, from Kadesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun and lead the way to Mount Tabor. And I will lure Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the Kishon River and give him into your hands." She gave him the whole plan. On one hand, it was simple. Surely Barak could have handled that. God gave the plan to Deborah. She gave it to him. All they had to do was to rally the troops, go into battle, and win the victory. It's kind of like, just go over there and walk over there and take it. But check out his timid response. After having all this given to him, laid on his plate, he doesn't have to do anything. And he says, "If you go with me, I'll go. But if you don't go with me, I won't go." We're talking about the military leader of Israel. And he's like, "If you go with me, honey, I'll go, but I'm not going without you." Excuse me for saying this, but that's just pathetic. It was a man's job to saddle up and to face the enemy. Being a man, a leader should have meant to having courage in the face of danger. I'm flabbergasted. Barak won't even go into battle. Everything's set up for him. Everything's already done. The plan's laid out. They've laid it, given it to him on a silver platter. And he still says to Deborah, "If you go with me, I'll go." And in case you think I'm being too hard on the guy, listen to what Deborah herself says. "Very well," Deborah said, "I will go with you, but because of the way you're going about this, the honor will not be yours, for the Lord will hand Sisera over to a woman." Even Deborah, a great leader in her own right, didn't like his response. What a mealy-mouthed, wishy-washy answer Barak gave. Can you imagine John Wayne talking like that? I can't see it in my crystal ball. But you can partly understand Barak's hesitation, because we find out in later verses that the Canaanites had something the Israelites didn't have. They had iron chariots. I mean, with an iron chariot, you don't have to worry about the wheel breaking or the floorboard falling out from under. You got some stability. Heavy stability, but you got some stability. Imagine those things were heavy. It'd be like a suicide mission for the Israelites to attack them, because the arrows wouldn't penetrate them. They're all kinds of armor there. So God sent a storm that flooded the Kishon River, trapping the iron chariots in the mud. That turned out into a total victory for the men of Israel. All these iron chariots, which they were so proud of, were out there stuck in the mud. Sunk down to their axles, and they weren't going anywhere. And it turned into a total victory for Israel. And in another ironic twist, Sisera, who was the captain of the Canaanite army, he escaped, true, only to be tricked and trapped and nailed to the ground by another woman, Jael, who drove a tent peg through his temple. I know that sounds gruesome, but it should have sent them the unmistakable lesson not to mess with these women. I mean, go out there and take on the army. Go for it, man, but don't mess with them women. But you see what I'm saying? She then said to Barak, she said, "Come and I'll show you the man you're looking for." And there was Sisera nailed to the ground with a tent peg in his temple. killed not by a man, but by a woman. And you got to understand, in the culture of that day, women just didn't do anything but stay home and make biscuits and raise the kids. So even though Barak led the troops in the battle, it was Deborah and Jael that got the full credit. Was Barak a bad guy? No. He was a good guy. He was just too weak and dependent on the women. But you got to give him the credit that he deserves, though, because he is listed in the Hebrews 11 in the book of heroes. As a man of faith, and he was, but he was timid, he was weak, when he should have been strong and a leader. Deborah and Jael were the real heroes of the day. Then there was Samson. Samson was just totally out of control. Paul again says, I don't have time to tell you about Samson. Most of us know the general outline of Samson's victory. We know about the defeat of the Philistines. We know about Delilah. We know about his eyes being poked out, and we know about his great strength, and he gained revenge by killing 3,000 of the Philistines in one of the most dramatic death scenes in the Bible. But there's much more to Samson than that. He's like the American Idol of the Old Testament. He had it all: good looks, great strength, popularity, and the blessing of God. But he threw it all away because he had a lack of self-control. Doesn't matter how talented you are, doesn't matter how strong you are, doesn't matter what you've got going for you, if you can't control yourself, you're in trouble. He threw it all away because of his lack of self-control. Of his life, it could truly be said that he had unlimited potential. No man in the Bible started out with as much going for him, and no man ended with less. He had it all, and he let it get away from him. It proves the point that it's very possible to be empowered by the Spirit of God to do great things. It is. And yet not to have your own life yielded to the full control of the Holy Spirit. Paul says himself to be careful lest you fall also. Samson is a bristling bundle of sad contradictions. He was a man of faith with a weakness for women. He was a man of prayer given to uncontrollable fits of anger. He was a leader of Israel who lusted after Philistine women. He was a man of God who lacked common sense. He was empowered by the Spirit, but yet he often lived in the flesh. That, in a nutshell, is Samson, a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma. He's listed in Hebrews chapter 11 as a man of faith, yet he regularly slept with harlots. When we read Samson's story, it's a sad tragedy. We think that his problem was all in the sexual area. Actually, his real problem wasn't that at all. His real problem was that he never learned how to control his emotions. Honey, that'll take you straight down every time. Because whatever area you're involved in, if you can't control yourself, your emotions, have a little bit of self-discipline, you're going down. First he was filled with lust. Then he's filled with anger. Then he's filled with lust again, and then anger again. Then he keeps going in this spiritual cycle over and over again. He's riding an emotional roller coaster, and he can't get off of it, seemingly. One moment he's worshiping God, and the next he's flirting with the Philistine woman. On one occasion, he leads the army of Israel to a stunning military victory by the power of the Holy Spirit. But then later, he's sleeping with a Philistine prostitute. Not long after that, he meets Delilah, the crowning jewel of his downfall. She seduces him into revealing the secret of his power, of his strength, which leads to his imprisonment and ultimately his death. Samson never learned to control his emotions, so they controlled him. And it'll happen that way every time. Proverbs 16:32 could have been written about him, and it says, better a patient man than a warrior, a man who controls his temper than one who takes a city. In his day, Samson had taken more than one city. He was quite the warrior. But he never learned to control his temper, his emotions. He never learned how to rule his own spirit. He never knew the first thing about self-control. In the end, his runaway emotions ran away with him. That's why it's important that we teach our children discipline so that they can discipline themselves. That's what it's all about. People say, well, I ain't getting on that bandwagon. I'm not going to get rough with my kids. Well, it's not getting rough with them. It's teaching them how to discipline themselves later in life. Most of the kids that are running wild, doing whatever they want to do and care less and getting into trouble are kids that never had 1 ounce of discipline when they were at home. It's as simple as that. He's deeply flawed, just like most of us. He finds himself continually battling anger and illicit desires, just like most of us. He could sometimes do amazing things for God, just like most of us. But then he could turn around and he could make some incredibly stupid mistakes, just like most of us. And yet he delivered his people from the Philistines just as the angel said he would. Judges 13:5. And then he shows up in Hebrews 11 as a hero. Now either we believe in the powerful redeeming grace of God or we don't. There's a lesson to be learned there. On our level, when we think about Samson, we think about all these others that are broken and make mistakes, we think, I'm done. If we'd been the potter with making the vessel and it became flawed and cracked, we'd throw it away. But God's mercy isn't like that. God's grace shown upon us, he'll take that broken vessel, pick it up, and make it into something beautiful. Either we believe in the powerful redeeming grace of God or we don't. How about Japheth? Japheth was foolish. Paul again says, I don't have time to tell you about Japheth, but he does. The first verse of Judges 11 tells you all the essentials about Japheth. Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty warrior. His father was Gilead. His mother was a prostitute. Don't overlook that last line, his mother was a prostitute. Jephthah was a leader in Israel during the time of the Judges. Mighty man. He's best known for winning a decisive battle against the invading Amorite army and also for a foolish oath that cost him his innocent daughter's life. Who was Jephthah? And why does Hebrews 11 count his relatively obscure man in with the other heroes of the faith? Although we can piece together a few general details from the historical time and place of Jephthah's life, just about everything else we know about him comes from the Old Testament book of Judges, chapters 11 and 12. His name meaning set free. He was the son of a man named Gilead from a tribal area of ancient Israel that was also called Gilead, which today is located in the country of Jordan. And he lived during the 12th century, and the Bible just says plainly his mother was a prostitute. Although allowed to grow up in his father's household, his father's home, this prostitute's son was eventually driven out by his half-brothers who didn't want him to share in their inheritance. Kind of makes you wonder how the mother felt about that too, knowing that this son was not even hers. The half-brothers didn't want to share the inheritance, so they drove him out. So he settled further east in the eastern edge of the Midian desert. There he set up shop as an outlaw prince, a man for hire, and a gang of scoundrels. In Judges 11:3 it says, a gang of scoundrels gathered around him and followed him. They earned the reputation of being skilled fighters for hire, and Jephthah himself became known as a mighty warrior. The Amorites, who were trying to correct what they saw as a 300-year wrong against them by the Israelites, would invade Israel. They were trying to get even. They were trying to get their land back. And that scared the elders of Gilead enough that they came to plead this exile bandit for help. Now, all of a sudden, this being a prostitute's son was no longer such a big deal. Not a big problem when you need a skilled fighter. But he'd also lived long enough that he had been influenced by pagan beliefs. And a bargain was struck. Jephthah would lead the Israelite army against the Ammonites, and if he came back victorious, they were going to announce him as king of that area. Big deal. Judges 11:29 reveals that then the Spirit of the Lord came on Jephthah. He advanced against the Ammonites. But upon seeing the enemy firsthand, when he saw them in their mighty assemblies, ready to do battle, he started having second thoughts. His confidence faltered. And uncertain of victory, he then followed the custom of the surrounding pagan cultures, and he struck a deal with God. He said, "If you give me the Ammonites into my hands, whatever comes out of the door of my house to me when I return in triumph from the Ammonites will be the Lord's, and I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering." One of the saddest stories in the whole entirety of the Bible. Scripture records, "Then Jephthah went to fight the Ammonites, and the Lord gave them into his hands." The victory was so decisive that he devastated 20 Ammonite cities. And thus Israel subdued Ammon. Now the new conquering king returning home to his glory and all of his pomp and circumstances and celebration. But when his daughter, his delighted only daughter, heard that her father was outside the door, she came dancing out to greet him. And Judges 11:37 reports that Jephthah's daughter was young, not yet married, but old enough to be thinking of marriage and a family. And in the ancient Middle East, girls commonly married at an early age, sometime in their mid-teens. So although we can't know for sure the girl's age, we know that probably she was in that age group, in that area. And the girl's joyful welcome of her father and the happy music of timbrels was so quickly silenced when Jephthah saw her, he immediately tore his clothes and he started screaming, "Oh no, my daughter, you've brought me down and I am devastated. I have made a vow to the Lord that I cannot break." Jephthah's little princess was given 2 months to mourn with her friends because she would never marry. Then in the sham service to God, the story goes that Gilead's new king carried out the pagan-style ritual of human sacrifices. Jephthah's grief was real to be sure, but he also had to have known that his vow meant that somebody close to him was going to die. A reckless decision on his part. And he knew the law of Moses that expressly prohibited anybody from practicing human sacrifices. He knew that to be a fact, because he knew the law of Moses. In light of that, some have suggested, and hopefully, that perhaps the daughter's life was spared, and that she lived to be into adulthood in perpetual virginity as the fulfillment of the vow. I hope that was the case. The Bible just doesn't give it enough real solid evidence to say one way or the other. But we have to assume from chapter 11, because it says, sadly, even though Jephthah was empowered by God's Spirit, he knew something of Moses' law. He didn't understand who God was or what God desired. But he knew the tragic depth of the sorrow of what he had done. Yes, he did rescue Gilead from the Ammonite invaders, and he subsequently defeated a serious threat from the Ephraimite warriors also. But in spite of all of that, he'll always be remembered as just the foolish, cruel father who sacrificed his daughter because of an unnecessary vow. He didn't have to make that vow. And after making that vow, since it was a pagan vow, he didn't even have to carry it through. Jephthah ruled Israel for only 6 years. Scripture makes no mention of anyone mourning his death. I can't imagine why. Or of any other children that were born to him. He not only sacrificed his daughter, but he also sacrificed himself. Because in the ancient world, when your seed passed through generations, you lived on. So he not only destroyed his family, but he destroyed himself also. So what are we to learn of the lessons of these four cracked pots? And what are we to think about these four flawed heroes, these four cracked pots, if you will? Gideon, who was afraid to answer God's call. Barak, who was so timid and fearful he needed a woman to tell him what to do. Samson, who couldn't control his emotions. Jephthah, who made a rash and tragic, foolish mistake in the vow. These are seriously flawed men. Yet they made the book in the chapter of the heroes of faith. Church, the lesson to be learned here is that if there is room for them, then undoubtedly there's room for you and I. Down deep, they were men of faith. They believed God and were willing to act on what they knew of God. Sure, they were very significantly flawed. They were literally cracked vessels, cracked pots, damaged material. They had some serious issues. But their significant faults cannot be overlooked, but those faults cannot and do not keep them out of the hall of faith. Again, a beautiful, mighty, powerful example of the grace of God bestowed upon you and I. Doesn't matter where you came from. Doesn't matter who you were, what you did, what your history was about. God's grace will cover it all. God will still put you in His book of faith. Amen. God uses flawed people to demonstrate His grace and His mercy so that when the victory is won, He alone gets the glory. Paul said the same thing in 2 Corinthians 4:7. He says, "Now we have this treasure in clay jars so that this extraordinary power may be from God and not from us." That's all we are, just clay pots, ordinary kitchenware, clay pots that are easily cracked and broken. We're not expensive china like that you might buy from New York City or some big store. We're ordinary Walmart kitchenware, useful but not expensive. We're all cracked and chipped, flawed in various places, yet God in His grace uses us anyway. God says, "Come on, I'll take you back. I'll take you back." So hang on to that word anyway, because Gideon was fearful, but God used him anyway. Barak was timid, but God used him anyway. Samson did a lot of dumb stuff, just like you and I, but God used him anyway. Jephthah made a terrible mistake in the vow that he made, but God used him anyway. Finally, I think it comes down to this. Either we believe in that redeeming grace of God or we don't. If we're going to come to God and not accept what He's going to do in our lives to clean us, to change us, to lift us up above all that stuff, that's what it's all about. We don't have to carry those mistakes of our past. We don't have to worry about those flaws, those cracks in our vessels, the insignificant things that says to the world, "I'm not perfect." Big deal. God says, "I'll take you anyway. I'll take you anyway." Either we believe in that redeeming grace of God or we don't. And I choose to stand upon that faith of believing that God accepts us as we are. Because He's got a plan to make you into something better. He's got a plan to change you, to lift you up, to fulfill you, to make you something you never even dreamed of being. If we do believe that God has a plan, then we're not going to be surprised that God can include these four flawed men into the Heroes Hall of Fame. Wouldn't it be great to get to heaven one day and there'd be another book there of the heroes of the Christian faith? And inside that book, you'd go over and look and open the pages and there you'd find your name. Sure, there'd be the history of all the faults you probably had, all the shortcomings that you were guilty of. But you'd also find that God used you. If we surrender our lives to God and let Him do what He wants to do in our lives, then honey, we're just as eligible for that book of Hebrews as anybody is. In a commentary of Hebrews 11:32, one theologian draws the following conclusion. He said, "Thus in all the saints, something reprehensible is ever to be found." And that's true. "Yet faith, though halting and imperfect, is still approved by God." Look in the mirror. You're surely going to find something reprehensible there. You're going to say, "Well, you know, there's this wrong and that wrong and something else, and I'm too skinny or too fat or too short, too tall, too something." But you know, that's where our mistake is at. We're looking at us instead of Him. Amen. We're looking at us instead of Him. Amen. And that's where we need to be. "There's therefore no reason why the faults we labor under should break us down or discern us, provided we, by faith, go on in the race of our calling." There's going to be times you're going to fall, you're going to stumble, you're going to skin your knees. Don't quit. Don't give up. God honors faith, and He seeks it so much that He'll honor people that otherwise would do some very stupid things. And I don't know about you, but I'm going to be honest. I've done some pretty stupid things. Don't give up. We all labor under a sense of our own failures. We all carry that burden of the old devil saying, "Well, look at what you did back there. Now you know you messed that up. Boy, you really messed that one up." But like Gideon, we're usually slow to answer the call. Like Barak, we need someone else to push us through the fear. Like Samson, we let our emotions instead of truth guide us wrongly. Like Jephthah, we continually say things that may ultimately hurt ourselves and others also. So let us push on by faith. Let us continue in this walk that we are walking, despite our failures, knowing that if God can use men like this, He can certainly use you and I. Philippians 3:7 says, "But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being conformed to His death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on. I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." Church, the wholesome issue of this sermon tonight is it doesn't matter how cracked, how flawed you may be. It doesn't matter the mistakes that you may have made, and Satan's going to pack them on you to make them weigh you down, and you're going to feel the guilt, you're going to feel the sorrow, and you're going to feel everything that he can put on you. But realize this, that God, through His mercy, through His grace, can still use you. You've heard it before. We've said it several times up here, and it's still true. If you don't quit, God won't quit. Stand to your feet. Father, we thank you tonight for your word. We thank you, Lord, for the lessons of knowing that Even us, in our flawed abilities, in our lacking, in the mistakes that we've made, Lord, that you're still willing to hold your hand out and say, come home, my child. Come home, my child. I'll clean you up. I'll make you into something better. I'll make you into something we can put in that book of the heroes of faith in the Christian life. And Father, we thank you that you have loved us enough, that you're willing to do that, to take us that are flawed and make something beautiful out of our lives. Take us from ashes and make us into something, Lord, that you can use. And Father, we give you glory and praise and honor tonight. And Lord, we just want to praise you and lift you up. Lord, let your spirit be our guide. And we ask it all in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. 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 God bless you. Love somebody.